Graph view. It looks pretty cool. At the beginning, I didn't really know the power of graph view, so today we're talking about how to use graph view in Obsidian. And ta-da! Alright, graph view, there are two types of graph views. The first one is the one that you see now. This is the global graph view, and there's also a local graph view. And today, I want to start with local first, because actually, especially when you're just starting Obsidian, local graph view can be so much more powerful. So let's get to it. Okay, let's open up a note. Say philosophy is like jazz. This is a very simple note. We've got a couple of links and we've got a tag. So let's open up local graph view to see what we can get out of this. Right now, it's not that useful, right? It literally mirrors the note here. You have the note itself and then the three notes that we're linking to in the note. So not very interesting, but if you open up filters here, out of the four options, so filters, groups, display, and forces, if you focus on filters for local graph view, it will give you a lot more power. So let's take a look. First, and the most important, is depth, this slider right here. It's set to one right now, which means that we're only going one level in depth, which is why there is the main note and all of the notes that we're linking to. So that's the first level of depth. But you can increase this, and as you increase, more notes that are linked to the notes that you're linking to will start to pop up. And so the deeper you go, the more notes that are going to show up. And I'll share with you a few use cases for depth in a moment, but just as a function, depth is very important. And then there are a few other toggles that can be helpful depending on how you set up your Obsidian. So right now we have incoming and outgoing links toggled on. So we'll see both links coming into Philosophy is Like Jazz and links going out of Philosophy is Like Jazz. Then you can also add neighboring links, which will give you even more notes that will show up as you toggle the depth. As well as you can have tags show up as well. So depending on how you set up your tags, this could also be very useful. And then you can have attachments show as well if you've got PDFs and images and those things. And you can also toggle on and off for existing files only. If you don't know what that means, at the very simple sense is there are two types of files that exist in Obsidian. One is existing files, which means it looks like a note like this, like there is a body to the note, not just a title. Whereas if it's a non-existing file, like these ones that are a bit grayed out, I haven't actually created the note. I just have a placeholder with the title of the note there. There's actually nothing in the note itself, and so that is a non-existing note. So I can toggle that on and off. And if I just come back to level one, that's probably easier to see. If I toggle existing files only on, there will only be one link because these two links here are non-existing files. Okay, hopefully I haven't confused you. This is not really a super important point, but here's local graph view. And now let me share with you the two use cases for local graph view that is so powerful and change how I take my notes. Use case number one for local graph view is when you start a new note. So there is no excuse to say, oh, I haven't, started anything, so I don't use the graph view. You can use it when you start a new note. And let me show you how. So I am reading this book, The Order of Time by Carlo Rovelli. I love all his books. And in here, he has an interesting thing I want to take notes on, which is on rebellion. So rebellion is perhaps among the deepest roots of science. The refusal to accept the present order of things. I love this concept of rebellion. I was the most rebellious kid in our family. And so let's see, let's start a note on this. And if you've been around for a while, you know that when I start a new note, I always do Command O to bring up search for files, and I put the keyword in to see if I've done something similar. So I can already put my mind into this connective thinking mode. And I wrote, philosophers are the OG rebels. Interesting. Well, okay, that's good to know. Let's start a new note first. So this one we'll call rebellion. Did I spell that right? Rebellion with two L's. Rebellion is as the root of science. Okay, let's start this new note. Let me just at the bibliography, this is Carlo Rovelli, The Order of Time. Okay. And the context is refusal to accept the present order of things equals rebellion. Whoops, why can't I spell rebellion? Equals the beginning of how science began. Okay. Now, if we want to start linking to ideas, we already know when we searched the files that this is perhaps related to the idea that philosophers are the OG rebels, right? Both are rebellious, which is interesting because physics is basically philosophy, and philosophy is very much related to physics. So that makes a lot of sense to me, but let's see, even if I didn't have that. Even if I remove this, let's see what will happen if we just increase the depth of our local graph view. The mystery of time. Sometimes playwrights are more philosophical than philosophers. Oh, interesting. So already we are seeing a philosophy come up, right? The two are related. Holding two opposing ideas at the same time. Creativity. I wonder what the connection is there. Thinking is not a linear process, which I really like. Related thinking is not a linear process. Okay, what this means is that rebellion is not a linear path, for example, right? We don't just follow someone else's path forward. We try to explore a little bit as rebels. So that's interesting. Let's see. Reality is not what it seems. I think that's also a really interesting idea because thinking in that sense, science, you know, very established, serious subject is actually rebellious at heart, right? We think of science as the source of truth, very objective, very logical, but it's not just objective, it's rooted in emotions. Okay, also very interesting. And, you know, now we're seeing, okay, there's not a linear path, there's emotion in this very objective and logical, seemingly logical field, right? This is interesting. It's kind of like a paradox, which is, of course, related to how can I hold two opposing ideas at the same time and function. Okay, let's keep exploring our ideas and see if we can get anything else. Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, here we go. Here is the philosophers are the OG rebels. Eventually, we end up there, even if we don't search. So let's bring that into this. Philosophers are the OG rebels, and we know that physics is science. I think I actually have a note on this. Let's see if I do. Physics is... okay, I literally have a note called physics is philosophy. Okay, so now it all makes sense, right? Like, philosophers are the OG rebels, not satisfied with status quo. Scientists, same thing. And this connection between physics and philosophy is just so tight. And okay, like, this note is starting to make sense. You know, it's a new idea, but very quickly we can see how it latches on to the ideas we already have in our vault. So that's the first powerful usage of local graph view when we make a new note. All right, there is a use case number two for local graph view, and it is when we process our notes. When we think through, let's say we took a bunch of literature notes and fleeting notes. Now we want to get to the permanent note level where we are thinking through the ideas and generating our own insights. This is actually a great place to use local graph view as well. So I'll just take the same example since we've already been working on this. And let's say now that I've come back and I want to write a newsletter about this, how can I, you know, figure something out and process these ideas? So first, we already went through, okay, some of our discovery was that, you know, rebellion is crucial to both science and philosophy. Philosophy and science are actually kind of the same things. Okay, interesting. Where can we take this idea? So let's go back to our graph view and let's just explore a little bit, see if anything jumps out. For example, here, concepts are arbitrary. Okay, interesting, right? Like we say I am studying physics, and so I'm a scientist, versus I'm saying, okay, I'm a philosopher, right? My head is in the cloud, and I think too much, or whatever the stereotype is. So perhaps we can use this idea to demonstrate that concepts are arbitrary. And let me just take a look at what are some of the notes I've written about under concepts are arbitrary. So placebo and side effects, scope switching, okay, looking for deep structural similarities, not superficial similarities. I really like this idea, looking for deep structural similarities, and let's see where that leads us to. Okay, Outliers, the book. Trouble creates intelligence. Again, this idea of the mismatch between concepts and reality, right? It's like, okay, science is very logical, but it stems from something very emotional, rebellion, you know, a refusal to accept some things. Okay, here we're talking about, you know, trouble creates intelligence. Actually, it's not, yeah, just studying that makes us smart. It is when we meet, you know, problems and we have to solve those that help us train for it. Stuff like this. Okay, that's very interesting. Let's see if I have any notes connected to this. How do we learn? Okay, interesting. You know, so now I can take this idea of rebellion as the root of science, linking it to how do we learn? Because actually, you know, self-directed learning. We talk about this, like how come some kids are self-directed, others don't, right? Maybe it stems from this emotional reaction to reality, right? Like if you're not happy with people just telling you, well, it is the way it is, so just, you know, study it, then perhaps you're more likely to learn in a self-directed way. Anyway, I'm not going to go further on this, even though I'm really excited about this. I'll probably write something on this. So let me just quickly write this down. So what I can do is then come into this note. What I did was press Command and click the link, and it will create a new link. And I realize I spell thinking wrong. And I will link to, what was it, How We Learn, and also, what else did I link to? Arbitrary. Concepts are arbitrary. Okay. I give myself enough hints so that I can continue down this rabbit hole. Because when I come here and I give it, you know, almost like a filter for which ideas are related. Whoops. Filter for which ideas are related. If I bring back down the depth, I can focus again, right? So here we, instead of a view on the previous page, which I had to go to level depth, like level 4 or 5 to see these ideas. Now, if I start here, then I'm able to focus on these ideas more clearly, right? And go further, because now as I increase the depth, I'll get all sorts of other notes that we didn't see in the previous local view. Things like selection criteria, the Matthew principle. As you can see, I'm super excited about local view, and just very quickly, it takes us down very interesting paths and help us make connection. Okay, now global graph view. This is what you usually see YouTubers show, something that looks like this. And as you'll see, it's still the same 4 things that we can do with this graph view. So filters, groups, display, and forces. In the local graph view, we already talked about filters, except it looks a little bit different from this. So what you can do here is filter out more things. Like if you click on it, you can see you can filter things by path, files, tags, lines, and sections. And if you want to filter by something, let's say a tag that says build, it'll give you all of the notes for that specific tag. You can also do a minus in front, and that means exclude anything with the tag build. So now I get the rest of my vault excluding the build files. And you can choose to display your tags on this view or not, depending on how you're using it. It'll show up in a different color. Same with attachments. I have quite a few images in my notes, so if I untoggle it, it will disappear. And then existing files only, we talked about this last time, so you can toggle on and off for that, as well as orphan notes. So you can toggle off and on to see orphan notes. A lot of mine are actually the images attachments. And I actually talked about how you can look at all of your orphan notes, so you make sure that you are latching your new ideas onto something, because sometimes we just take a very quick note. We don't actually spend time linking into something else, so it's good to refresh. And I talked about it in this video, so check that out after this video. And that's basically filters. Very easy. You can play around with that. Then is groups. So this is trying to group your view with different colors. So for example, if I want all my tags that has the hashtag YT to be red, then you'll start to see them. Then display. So again, this is also very visual. So you can see, you can choose to have arrows pointing to different notes. So now you'll see this if we click Thinking Duality, we see that, what is this? This morning brew note is pointing to Thinking in Dualities, and then this Thinking in Duality is pointing to Vice and Virtue. So that's arrows. You can have text fade threshold, which means when does the text disappear. The higher the number, the longer they remain faded, so you really have to zoom in to get them. And then we have node size. So these are all the circles, you know, higher, lower, personal preference, as well as line thickness. Very intuitive. And here's the button to animate, which brings me to the first use case is honestly global view. It just feels good to see that ideas in my head are visually presented to me and I can watch them grow over time. Like, that's kind of insane. And that's my favorite use case for global view. It's just a little self-satisfaction. Otherwise, you can also play with forces. So this is just how much gravity does the note have towards something. So if it's center force, then it condenses all the notes to the center, so you don't have much space in the middle. There's also repel force, so how much each note repels each other. The bigger it is, you'll get a bigger graph. More space in the middle, the smaller it is, the tighter the circle is going to be. Link force, same here. So if two things are linked, it will be closer together if you bring up the link force. Personally, I find it easier to have a higher link force so you can see how your ideas cluster. And link distance is just how far away they are from each other. So the closer they are, you'll be able to see the cluster more clearly. Two, again, use cases. The first one I already told you, satisfaction. The second one is as you build over time, you'll be able to see clusters of your ideas, and they'll grow in size. So the nodes that have more ideas connected to it will grow over time. The more nodes you have, the more you're going to get out of GraphView. So check out this video for how to take atomic notes, and I will see you in the next video. Bye.